introduce Umashankar Periodi, but he needs no introduction. But I'm also compensating for not doing the honors when Anant Gangola was here. Ideally, I should have been there to introduce Anant, but that opportunity escaped because I was away in Mysore on some other work. And I can't make it up to Anant, but at least I can ensure that I'm there to introduce my good friend. The introduction that has come to you in mail is already available with you. And it says, we all call him Peri lovingly. But that's not factually correct. If you see my mobile and you look for Peri, you will not find Peri's name here. But if you look for Uma, you will find Uma there. Umashankar Periodi is known as Uma to friends. But then what happens when two, three other Umas join the foundation? They're all ladies. So the man gives way. So we said, aaj se aapka naam Peri hai. And he became Peri. But the old habits die hard, so although I call him Peri in public, when I am with Uma, then it is very natural for me to say Uma. I joined the foundation in 2002, as you all know. I was probably employee number 2 or 3, and it's been great because I've been able to learn. Uma is just right behind us because in the year 2003, when we were starting to do some serious large-scale school assessments, in our program called Learning Guarantee Program, Kalika Thakri Karyakrama, we realized that we needed a field captain, a field commander who will take care of the evaluation of 1,887 schools in a short period of time, conforming to quality and running it like a super operation. And we were very lucky that at that time, Uma and we got together. Uma joined us and he's there with us. I'm here personally because Uma and I go back that long and have worked together. And Uma's experiences transcend much more than these 8 years. Uma can tell you wonderfully moving and meaningful stories of his engagements with the Soliga tribes and what he's done out there in the B.R.Hills for many years. He can talk to you of his various fights that are behind the fact that he wears this khadi kurta all the time. There are stories behind that, it is up to us to extract those stories from. The colloquium for us is a combination of learned academics coming and sharing things, but it's also a space for eminent practitioners to come and share with us. This thing about theory and practice actually is a very artificial divide in our mind. Because I think good theory informs good practice and good practice informs good theory in a seamless cycle of continuous improvement. We began with the Learning Guarantee Program, worked together, but subsequently, a few years later, we worked with what is known as the Balasnehi Shale Karyakrama, which is the child-friendly school program. Uma will probably share with us all his experiences of the child-friendly school program. And like most of the programs of Azim Premji Foundation, and probably many others if they were honest, no trajectory of any of the programs is like this. It is a constant spiral of agony, hope, ecstasy, despair, hope, improvements, etc. If you are extremely rigid about your hypothesis and you find reality pushing you, you break. If you are too weak and unformed, you will keep getting swayed by all the inputs that come. The beauty is, how do you manage a very flexible yet focused and purposeful journey of your program? Second, very interestingly, we are complementary. I keep asking for numbers. Hindi wale kahenge na, aankde chahiye mujhe. So every time I will say, isme kya percentage hua, uska kya percentage hua, iska standard deviation dikha do, etc. And Uma will have a quiet smile on his face. He never says no, but he knows all the time that ye sab thoda limit se rakhna chahiye. I got other measures of impact with me. So between the two of us, we used to find meaning and measures of a program that has gone. So it's a great pleasure for me to introduce Uma, number one, and number two, I think a great opportunity for you to listen to what's been happening on the ground. There's an enormous fund of information, knowledge, experience that he will share with you, and knowing him, I think he will throw it open to all of you. I'm delighted that he doesn't have a PPT and he'll speak from the heart. But I have a PPT and I'll show it to you. This PPT, by the way, don't believe it, huh? He's kept it there, but after a few minutes, you'll realize that he doesn't move the slides. It goes on. So, isko main abhi short circuit karne wala hu. this is all the theory there. This is the theory there and this is the practice. This is Umashankar, by the way, a teacher training in Surpur. Umashankar, all the community ladies. No community. This is a story of a newsletter. Teachers still don't have a habit of reading newsletters. Uma has to convince them to read newsletters. Uma and I have crossed the river, but the others are crossing the river. This is going too fast, but it's very difficult to get people to come and work in Surpur. So when one day came to work with us, we tried to make him happy with the game. Uma is submitting his monthly report to his boss, and I'm submitting my monthly report to my boss. And we are doing what we like best, having chai. Thank you very much. Over to you.
Thank you, Ji. Such a wonderful introduction. So, two things before starting. One, that I will not be saying anything that you have not heard from different places, different people. You have heard these things, so nothing new, so don't expect anything. Second, the reflection, basically it will be reflections, and the reflections are not only mine, the reflections are of my team members, reflections are also of people like Giri and a lot of people who have come there to see the work. So it's all these things I am bringing to you. So it's nothing only mine. It is not me. So we just go through. So just to look at CFSI, how did it start? Yeah? Are you projecting? No? Okay. That was a that he said that. Don't worry about the projection. I'm projecting myself. Good. So, see this. In foundation, we have this culture of learning from the projects that we have done. So, if you go back in 2000, 2001, to get a feel of the schools, how they are, what they are, what it is to really. What's happening in the school, I think we started working with the potential dropout children to check the potential dropout children, children who drop out. So looking at that, we said those children who are slow learners, if we can concentrate on them in the school, then probably the dropout rate will. So that is how we started accelerated learning. And we had this accelerated learning program in nearly 1,000 schools. And that gave us a lot of insights. And one of the insights that we got was that everywhere in education, everything is geared towards exam. Everything is towards exam, classroom, processors, everything is towards exam. So then we thought that we should work on this. And that's how we started working on assessment-led reforms. And in that, the program was Learning Guarantee Program, which we piloted here from 2003 to 2005. Now, this was a very interesting program, a flagship program of foundation, and it gave us a very interesting learnings. I'm not going to deep into the detail of LGB, because that itself is a very huge program, and both of us are immersed in it so much that we might only speak about it. So, but there, what happened is, as we gave back the results of this learning guarantee program to school, we encountered three different types of teachers. A set of teachers said that we have seen these results. We know where our children are. We know where our schools are. We know this is the amount they have learned. So this is nothing new. This is one set of teachers. There was another set of teachers who said, oh, this is interesting, this is new, we need to do something, but immediately we cannot do it, we will do it later, and they kept it. And like most of us who keep things for later days, we don't pick it up. So they have left it there. But there was one more section of teachers who said a very important thing. They said, this is new. We did not know about it. We want to do something, but we don't know how to do it. See, this became a very important thing because our LGP was an output-based program. We were only assessing them and awarding them and taking their learning and sharing it with others. But this particular thing that assessment, once you do, then there is a need to give input for improvement, was a very important response that we got from the teachers. And probably that is what has triggered us to start a program which is integrated, where everything is there. And if you see child-friendly school initiative, it's an integrated program. What happens in child-friendly school initiative? How was it designed? Come back. I think there was a very important person, Sri M.N. Baig, who was deputed from the department to foundation. And he was at the joint director level. So he was the person who designed this program. And when he designed it, see, he designed it for quality, to provide quality education to all the children in a child-friendly manner, involving all the stakeholders. So this was the basic objective of this program. So when you say quality education, what is quality education? Most of you will have a lot of your own objectives and your understanding, but at that point of time, what they saw was that in a school, if you want to provide quality education to the school, then there are five areas that we need to work on. One of the areas is school environment. The other area is classroom environment. The third area is teaching learning process. And if you want to do those things, you will need a quality teacher. So, you will need teacher academic development. And for all these things to sustain, you will need the community participation. See, this is something that they designed. They said, we will go to school and work in these areas, these five areas. And what they did is, in these five areas, there were three different parties who got involved. One is Azim Premji Foundation, Government of Karnataka, and UNICEF. All three designed this program and they chose Sudershan. Now, why Sudershan is a question? Could be any other block. This is a block, this was a block in Gulbarga district. Now it is a block in Yadgir district. Now what is the uniqueness of this block? This block, if you see the human development index, it is 201 out of 202. Literacy rate is very low. And the difference between the male and the female literacy rates, the gap is very huge. It's a drought prone area. Very less rain, neglected because it is in the border, and this is one area where feudal element is still thriving. When I said still thriving, we have a king there, and he comes up and he speaks to us and conducts sports, and some of the sports are war games. And then after this course, he gets into a platform, and the last ritual is throwing coins like this to the people. And this, even today, it's happening in Shorapur. So this is the area that they have taken. Along with this, it is one of the areas where, which is because of the feudal elements, violence is very, very high there. You will have seen recently that they are not satisfied by killing one leader. always when they kill a series of leaders. One party kills the other party, one leader, slightly higher in that hierarchy they will move and kill the other, and on that hierarchy they will move up and kill the, and when there is a solemn killing last year, they burned some 16 buses and the DC had to camp there for 3 days. This type of a very violent thing. So this was so, and this we started working in this area. And in this area, we took the entire block, and this is very important, that we have taken 350 schools that they are in that block and worked with all the 350 schools. We worked with all the education functionaries of that block till the level of BEO, the block education officer. This was one very important thing why we took Surpur as one area. It is very difficult. The terrain is difficult, but I think if we can succeed in this place, we might have got a lot of lessons, and we the possibility of succeeding in other places is enormous. So we started there, and in the whole work that we did, I would like to break it into three parts, just for our understanding. One is 2005 to 2007. This I call establishment phase. And 2008 to 2010, I call this exploration phase. And 2010, now it is the extension phase. I'll just briefly explain to you what happened in these three phases. The first phase, establishment, see, we went there and established in that. When we say established, actually really established, Mr. Beg went there, he lived in that place, and he went to all the schools, he spoke to the BU, and we went there. The first program that we did in establishment is training program, a heavy training program of 10 days residential to all the head teachers. 300, I think then it was only 308 schools that were there. Now it is 350 schools. All the 308 head teachers were trained. They were trained on subject, they were trained on pedagogy, and they were trained on management. So that was the one thing that we did. The second thing that we did was, see, I have spoken about these areas. And I have also said that UNICEF is there. So when UNICEF comes, what comes in? Any guess? Indicators. They are the mother of indicators. You ask anything, UNICEF will have an indicator. Yeah. So they came with indicators and they said this, they broke into some 35, 36 indicators, this into some 65 indicators, this into some 40 indicators, and everything put together, it was 214 indicators. These indicators, though they look very huge, they are very simple indicators which gave us an idea as about where the school is. Like one indicator I will tell you, clean drinking water available for all children. This is one indicator. Now this is a very important indicator, that clean drinking water is available for all the children to drink. And initially when we started, I think at least 50% of the schools did not have this indicator. So it is that type of an area. So what this whole thing from here they took is, they started the work of school improvement plan. They took each and every indicator, they went to the school, they saw which indicators the school has and which indicator the school doesn't have. And then they worked on a plan to see that they have the indicator. And this plan had what to do, how to do that, who is responsible for that, and by when it will happen. And this plan that was there for each and every indicator in all the schools, this was the school improvement plan. And to monitor the school improvement plan, we had 25 margadarshis. So each margadarshi will have some 12 to 15 schools. They will go to the schools, they will monitor these things, what is happening, what is not happening, and then work on this. So you had, by now you had started this process, you had gone to each school, collected all the stakeholders and with them discussed about the indicators and gave them an idea about the school, what is there in that school, what is not there in that school, and what should happen by this year end. And to monitor that, you had the teachers. So this is how we started work here. You had the head teachers now who were who had some idea of this program, who were open to this thing, and the school improvement plan happened. And then we started a process of entering into the teaching learning. We went into the classroom processes where we started working with the first and second year, second class children. See, this process also was a very important process known as Nali Kali. It is multi-grade, multi-level, activity-based teaching learning process. Something taken from Rishi Valley satellite schools where they have started this. Long back, Karnataka had sent Mr. Bain himself and a few teachers to Rishi Valley to understand this process. So they had come, it was going on. But here, once Mr. Bain went to this place, he immediately concentrated, and out of the 308 schools, 110 schools we had this process. Now this process of multi-grade, multi-level, activity-based teaching learning process. Why multi-grade and multi-level? Just one or two. See, multi-grade because we have very less teachers in rural areas. So 1 to 5, either you have 2 teachers or 1 teacher. So all the grades will be together, so multi-grade. And second, even in one grade, the levels of the children will be very different. So multi-level. So most of this was designed by them and it was implemented here. Now the uniqueness of this program is that here in Sudershan this was a success. This was a success for one very important reason. What Mr. Bay did is he trained the teachers and then he provided two very powerful support. One was the on-site support for the teachers. So the teachers who were conducting the first and second class in Nali Kali, they were given on-site support. The Margarshis would go to the classroom, help the teachers to conduct the classes, help them to prepare the prerequisites. And then the second support was the forum support. Every month, all teachers of Nali Kali classes would meet and they would deliberate on the different aspects of the Nali Kali teaching learning process. The problems, next month what they have to teach, what they have taught, that what are some of the things, some of the loopholes. So this combination of on-site support and forum definitely helped in making Nali Kali a success. And after 2-3 years, a lot of people from the state came to see this place. And in 2010, government of Karnataka took a decision that we will have multi-grade, multi-level, activity-based teaching learning process in all the 45,000 schools of Karnataka. See, this success in 110 schools was something very important to take a decision. So this, by then, I think, it was 2007 and Mr. Baig had to leave. He had to take the directorship in ESCRT and that was the time when we went. Now when we went, I and some of my colleagues were working in this area. We saw and then we were trying to see what is this situation. See, there is a catch. Mr. Baig was the authority in Nali Kali. Mr. Bay was also a higher level officer. And Mr. Bay had a lot of goodwill because he was a very sincere officer, hard worker. And Periodi was a nobody. here was a person who was not from the education field, here is a person who is not in the education department. So I think it became very difficult for them to really see and place me in situation. So I was also looking at this and seeing how to move forward. So one thing I very clearly understood was that the leadership of this entire program will have to be with the department people. Here it would be BO. The BO is the head of the block. So he will have to lead, otherwise the teachers wouldn't accept this program because now the joint director is not there. So then we worked our entire process to see that the leadership is taken, ownership is taken. You can't give ownership. It has to be taken by the BO. Interestingly, the BO to meet me, it took some 4 months for a first interview of Azim Premji Foundation, one head of CFSI, to meet the BO at a block level. It takes 4 months. Not that he outright rejected me. He was just saying, today I have some other work. Please come tomorrow. When I go tomorrow, he is not there. He has already gone to school. So it really took 4 months. But that 4 months we were in the field doing a lot of work. I think after that, slowly we started meeting. And to really accept us, it took nearly 1 year for him. He saw our work in the field, the sincerity, the hard work in which we do, and then slowly he started accepting us. There were other things that we did with him. One, we continuously communicated to him what our plan was. And then we planned with him. The plan we took, we sat with him, we planned with him, we took time with him, we invited him to all our programs. So this way slowly he got to know of the program and slowly started accepting and interacting with us. And then we started the newsletter. And we asked him to be the editor of the newsletter. That was the time when he said yes. And that was the total buy-in. So from there, he's completely. There was one more thing also that happened here. McKinsey people had come. So they helped us to review the program. See, a lot of things are happening in this program. But as Giri was saying, the learning levels were not going up. So in a program, learning levels were not going up. It was there. So, and there was not a lot of correlation between the school improvement plan and the learning level of the McKinsey. When he came, there was on Bible. He was in the field for one full week, and at the end, 8 hours, he did a review. And in that review, he said, and he pointed out that all these things are fine, but in an education program, if the learning levels of the children don't move, you have no problem. So you will have to concentrate on learning levels. You have to concentrate on teachers. You have to concentrate on children. And that was the time when we started working with the teachers. For the teacher development, we started 2-3 things. One is newsletter. Newsletter is interesting because teachers don't read. They don't write. So making them read and writing itself was very difficult. So initially we would write and in their name publish with a photograph. So they would show the photograph. In between they would show our newsletter also. Later slowly they would write something which was not very meaningful. We would make it meaningful and publish. Now we are in a state after that we get enough materials from the teachers to be published. And this is led by BO. And see, just a newsletter doesn't help. If it is an integrated program, then it helps. Because now when the BO conducts a meeting, he will ask if you have read the newsletter. And in some places, when there is a good article, he will give 5 to 10 minutes time for the teachers to read the newsletter. So this is how newsletter makes meaning in an integrated program. Then we started a teacher learning center for the development of the teacher's capacity building of the teachers. What happens in a teacher learning center? Teacher learning center is a space where teachers can come on their own. There is library, very good library, and there is science equipment, math kits, and also some space for them to work on the internet. We have computers also. So this is a place where they come on their own, and we have four such teacher learning centers. So here also the interesting thing was, we thought that the teachers would run this center, and for 6 months nothing happened. No teachers came and no running happened. So after some time, we said that we need a coordinator. So we brought a coordinator, and coordinator started working there. And after 6 months, we saw that nobody is coming. So coordinator is there, books are there, equipments are there. Nothing is really happening. Only after that, after some 6 months, one of our coordinator, Dilip, he took the books and some science equipments to schools. He went to schools, from one school to the other school, showed it to teachers, showed it to children, did some experiments there, and then built the relationship, and then teachers started slowly asking about this, and you say, things come there, there are enough more. And that is how slowly people started dripping in. And once we got this, in all the other teacher learning centers also we did this. Today it's a very vibrant place where teachers come on their own, take books, take equipments, do experiments, come back. They have also added games, course material, push, and a lot of digital materials are also there. So this is a very vibrant place that we have started creating. This is very important because, see, this place is not a place where they come on the order of people. This is a place where they come voluntarily. So the success of the program is based on the voluntary involvement of the teachers for their own development. And the third thing which he raised was that the relationship with the community is not complete. There isn't a real good relationship with the community. So we were looking at it, and by looking at it, we saw that both these parties have some love-hate relations. They want each other, but they can't tolerate each other. So the parents somehow feel that the teachers are not doing it properly. They are doing some mistake. They don't come in time, all those things. And the teachers feel that these people are nuisance. Once they come to the school, they will create all sorts of problems. They will start asking questions. So they keep them out. Now, we also found one more thing. When the parents come, the way the teachers involve is very interesting. They start scolding. The first scolding is for their children, for not doing their work, for not coming in time. And the next scolding is for themselves, that they are not coming for the meeting. And the third scolding is for the others who have not come for the meeting. These are coming. So the people have come. So scolding is scolding. Nothing gets scolding. So we thought that is there a place that we can create where both these parties respect each other? Because respect is the key. So then we were thinking of this space, and we came upon this mela. Take a subject and create a mela around it. So to come to this mela idea also, there was a lot of work that we did. First we did focus group discussion in some 86 villages, and then we went to some 110 villages, taking a play, a jata, from one village to the other, creating awareness about the importance of the girl child education, and then we started the mela. In the mela, to take maths as a subject, there will be a lot of games and exhibitions and activities that others can do in the mela, which the child will facilitate. Now, for the child to facilitate, the teacher will have to work with the child for nearly 1 month. because it is not rote learning. The child will have to do it with the parents, with the teachers, with the children, whoever comes to the meeting. And any questions can be asked by them. So the child will have to get ready to all those things, all those challenges. So the teacher do a lot of work. So this preparation part itself became a very important thing, where the relationship between the teacher and child improved. There was a democratic process because both the teachers also did not know many things. So they were learning in this process. And then when parents came, very interesting things happened. See, one village, they will call some 6 to 7 villages around. All the children from those schools, all the parents and teachers. They come there and they have this mela, huge mela. Now very interesting things happen. When a parent comes and sees their children performing, they feel very great. They feel that their self-esteem goes up. They feel very good about the children, about themselves. And then they feel that these things the children have done, for the children to do, it is the teachers who have worked slog. So they will invariably go to the teachers and say, "You have done very well. My child is doing very well." See, in this process, there is one more thing that happens. When a huge crowd comes, the teachers can't manage a huge crowd. So the huge crowd comes, and in this crowd, everybody is fed, because whenever people come to the village, they don't go back in hunger, empty stomach. Only in cities we go back. In villages we don't go back. So what happens is when they come, this amount of food to be prepared, the teachers start. So the involvement of the parent is inevitable and it is very important. So it is not like the earlier days that you come for a meeting. It is calling them with respect. Please come, prepare this, manage these people so that our school succeeds. So this was something which brought them across the table on the same platform and with respect. And today we have done some 110 melas in different parts of the block, and it has been very successful. And one thing, in 2008 when we did the metric mela, the report and the video we had sent to the secretary and we had spoken and our people had gone there. And then order was passed from the government that all the 45,000 schools should have metric. And they did have at different levels in their own way, but that's fine. So this was one that has happened. So Mela and teacher learning center, and we did a lot of teacher interaction meetings, teacher development, because ultimately we found by 6-7 years that ultimately the core is developing the teachers. So that is how the entire thing was centered around. So at the end of this phase, there was an interesting thing. And then we slowly saw that things were falling in place. And for the first time, we saw that the gap of the learning level of the children was going up. This was in 2009-10. So we started in 5, almost 10, 11. We saw a slight improvement in the level. And they showed a consistency in that, that it was not from only the top quarter. It was from all the 4 quartiles that there is an improvement in the learning levels of the children. At this stage, we also had a review and we said that at this process, how do we take this forward? And we came upon this, that there is a need for an intensive, focused intervention. So we said inside the classroom, we will have some schools. We will focus on that and see what the result is. We will also work with the community, take Gram Panchayat as a unit. We will focus that and we will have focused intervention with the community. And then with the TLCs, the Teacher Learning Centers as kids, we will work with the education functionaries to support the teachers. So at present, this is the focus that we are having. We have a few Margadarshis working on classroom processes, very systematically a few community processes with the Gram Panchayat as the base and a few, especially the four people working on education functions to support the teachers. So with this, I think we are at a stage now of seeing how it can be extended to other areas. Just to give you a few, this is what I have to speak about our process, but in case about the insights and learnings we have to put together, with that I will stop. Few things. One is that silos don't work. When you work in the field, you will have to integrate with others. You have to work with others. Silos don't work. And integration is the key. So you have to work with the government, you have to work with the other NGOs, you have to work with the unions. So this is one very important learning there. The second important learning is change takes time. It is gradual. Especially in education. You can't expect anything in 3 years, in 2 years. There is a time that is needed. So you'll have to be patient, you'll have to be, it is gradual. Okay? And if you are in the field, you can see the changes, some of the changes. But those changes are not enough to be projected to the outside world. This change is enough for you to keep you working. You see a spark in the eyes of the child, that is enough for me and my people to work in the field. But if you say in a meeting, in larger, that I see spark in the child's eye, they will laugh at you. So that is the difference. So for that you will need. And then very important is support the partners to succeed. See, you succeeding is one, but you are working with partners. Government, you see that the government succeeds. You see that the paper carries the government's name, their officer's name. See, this is a very important thing, very interesting. And I feel very happy that I'm working here with this policy that we have. We are media shy. So, initially, when we started working, this media people would come and they would ask for an interview. So, I would say, my interview, and they would say, you know, things have happened in the school. I said, which school? Government school. It's a government school, it's not a school. It's a government school. So, government school, things have happened, so write about it. No, you have a, it's a government school. Who will give them? Then I said, see, government school head is PO. Go to PO. He will say what has happened. So, they would go. And he would say, and we found that from 7-8 months, this BO wouldn't utter a word of Azim Premji. But gradually after 1 year, you could see that he would say things and at the end would say, we have Azim Premji Foundation in this block. I found that rather than my interview coming in a full page, that one line from the BO has more value and impact than this. So this is a very important thing, that you see that the partners succeed. And then the ownership should be with the stakeholders. Community participation, BU, government, everyone. So ownership should be with them. Working together gives you the power to negotiate. See, this is a very important thing. I will give you a very small example of what I mean. Now in a mela, after a few melas, the government saw that this is a very successful thing. Because you can call the leaders, you can call everybody, and it is a mela, and it gives immediately papers will cover. So they immediately started conducting mela. And their mela was very interesting. They started 10:30. And 10:30 to 12:30 is the inauguration. And 12:30 to 1 is what time? 1 to 3 is food. Lunch. 3 to 3:30 is the thing, and 4 completely the concluding session. And in these, the two main things, inauguration and concluding, they will have leaders, everybody coming. So children would hardly get half an hour or 45 minutes. So it was a very big thing for us now. How do we speak to them? So we started speaking to them. And then they said, no, no, we need, because these are leaders who give us a lot of things. They sanction a lot of things. They said, but it is meant for the children. So they said, yeah, but children are there, so let them be there. He said, just being there is not important. They have to go, they have to see, they have to learn. So it came to a time. Then we said, we will not have any functions at all. We'll just have melas. So they said, no. We should have function because that adds value. Then we came to a negotiation. We said, we will not have the morning function. The mela starts at 9:30. And then it goes on till 4:30. 4:30 you have your function. You call anybody. We are not there. Then they said, no, you have to be there. We will at least forego that morning function. Evening function will be there, but you should be there. He said, fine, yes. Now see, this is a negotiation that is possible when you work with them shoulder to shoulder. And this, a lot of things can happen. You can bring your point to them. And most of these things you will know, being flexible and organic helps to move faster. People think that being flexible hinders your speed, but actually being flexible in the field helps you to move faster in negotiation. If you go with a set stone cast plan, everybody will have a question. But if you have a flexible plan where their element also can be included, then the plan will be accepted. And take help when needed. See, our team was a very poor team. Poor in the sense, we are not from education domain. I am not from education domain, I am from development domain. And my team members, most of them are from education, not from education domain, from development. So what did we do? When we saw that now the most important thing is academics, then immediately we looked for help outside, and we got very good help from Vidya Bhavan today. Some of you might know Dr. Uday Khan Diwan. So he was able to help us right from 2008 till today. In a year, he has 3 to 4 sessions with us, 10 days, 12 days session with my Margaret to build their capacity. So some of the things, no immediate gains. So no correlations. What helps here is the big picture. If you have the big picture, then you can place these things which has no correlations. This is what it is. And a lot of learning that we have is about the grassroots advocacy. See, like for example, when we were extending from Shorapur to the other North East Karnataka, Yadgir. So when we went to the DC to introduce ourselves and say that we would like to move and come to Yadgir, I went there inside and I said, I'm from Azim Premji Foundation. So immediately she said, I'm informed. See this, I am informed, and then I did not have to work with her on the PP. She immediately said, I have some problems, we'll have to solve it. Why don't we sit down? And the next discussion was on that. So all the subordinates, her subordinates, had said about this, about our Shorapur work, about our other GP work, things like that. So that, I feel, that advocacy is a very powerful advocacy. And till the secretary, I can tell you this, even the secretary at this level also knows about the Shorapur work. Not because of us, not because of the paper. They don't believe those two things. It is because their subordinates have said something about you. Their officers who are lower at the line officers. And third thing is, only empowered team can deliver. So if you have something to deliver and if your team is there, you will have to continuously upgrade it and empower. Without empowering the team, you can't deliver. and we have been investing a lot on the just to conclude, you cannot avoid dirtying your hands when you are in the field. A lot of things come which are nice to do, which are not very nice to do. But in the field, you have to dirty your hands. A lot of things which are not very, very good, like union leaders catching hold of our managers, trying to beat them. And the response that we give is also not like Jesus. Can't do another slap. You'll have to also show that you are also strong. So it is not very easy, but you will have to dirty your hands when you are in the field. Just to say a few challenges, you will know this. Sustainability is one challenge. Whatever we have done, sustaining that. If we come out from that, how will it sustain? What are the processes? That's one challenge. Building the team for all the changes, that is one challenge, because we don't get talent there, we don't get people there. And who come also, they leave. So building the team, keeping the team is a challenge. And it's a feudal system. So fighting the feudal system is one more challenge. And bringing all stakeholders together, because school, the different stakeholders have different interests. And some of them are opposing interests. Bringing them together is also a challenge. Till some 2-3 years back, the unions, teacher unions had not spoken to us much. But now they have started speaking to us. So that is one more challenge. We have to see how to negotiate with the teacher unions. Because all our work, as they see, is more work for the teachers. So they will resent it. They will start negotiating more. And this whole thing of capacity building of 1,600 teachers, almost 50 education functionaries, SDMCs, which will come to some 3,500, this scale itself is a challenge. And this whole thing of we have to go in depth and focused and also scale, maintain the scale. These two are contradictory things. So that also is a challenge. And the third one, last one, is the replication. How do you replicate a very intense program of such sort? Very intense, very focused. How do you replicate it in other places? This is my workshop. So I think that's what I had to say. So now you can respond. I'm wording it properly. One question, that's fortunately, we have not had the transfer. But in other places, you will see that they change every 3 years, 2 years they change. But this was one place where they have not changed till now. But now he is due to a promotion very soon. That was one thing. But below the BO level, if you are working in a block, in a district, the transfer is not much, because the transfer is between the block and the this person is a local.
No.
Local person, I'm quite sure.
So he wants to stay there.
People want. Yeah.
You always tell it well, Peri, so it's great to listen to it. But the last point that you raised about the replication, I think, what are your thoughts on that? Because the model that you have implemented at Shorapur is a fairly intensive model.
Yeah.
And I can see that it would be a real challenge to upscale such a model.
Thank you. I'll just say what we are thinking of this. So this is a very huge challenge, and we have been thinking of it right from 2008. 8 was the thing, then once we thought of closing this program and things like that, a lot of things. See, now what we see is, if you look at the Margadarshis, they are working in 12 to 15 schools. And it is possible to work in those schools for one person. What we are seeing now is that the with the change, the recent government number of CRPs has also increased. If you look at their number of schools, it is 18 units, which is also 12 schools. When they say units, the lower primary school is one unit and the higher primary school is two units. So if there is a combination of a few lower primary and higher primary school, it will not be more than 12 schools for one CRP. This is one thing. So what we are thinking is, this Margadarshi, what the person does today, if you go into the CRP's role, what he or she is supposed to do, it almost matches what this person is doing. So we now would extend this through the CRPs. The work is to motivate the CRPs and to build the capacity of the CRPs. See, most of the CRPs will complain that they are doing only postman work. You have seen that, they are complaining that you don't get into academic work. But it is also true that many of them don't know anything about the academics. That is why they have taken this and they are doing this business going here and there. So, we'll have to motivate the CRPs and build their capacity and then work towards this type of a process. This is possible. Now, in Shorapur, we have started this work. So, most of the CRPs are combined with one Margadarshi and they are working together. Now, when we are extending to Yadgir, the extension is through CRPs. So, that is how we are looking at the replication. That whatever these people were doing, we can do this. See, some of the details, you know, I told you, Nalikali. That is success. That success is because of on-site support and a forum. Every month they meet and they discuss. And there is somebody who goes after that to the classroom, speaks to the teacher and gives them some input. So this is possible to be given by a CRP. In fact, that is his work. So we would like to extend it through this. And some of the CRPs who are good at academics, they do give. So we can train them, we can work with them to develop them towards a good, vibrant CRP. And that is possible.
Just to be training the teachers, what are the tensions, challenges for training?
Not a repeat question. When training the teachers, what are the challenges? See, the challenges are that many of the teachers, the content, the subject level itself is very poor. So it is not training on pedagogy or teaching learning materials. It is hardcore subject that is needed. This was a very interesting learning for us. When we started, once we started teaching learning materials, TLM, but that doesn't help if the subject knowledge itself is very weak. I have found head teachers who do not know simple subtraction. I have found teachers who do not know carry forward. So the training is from them, and fortunately the team that came to train us knew about this. So Hardy is somebody who has been in the field, so he starts from there. That is why it helps. So that is one. And pedagogy, with the subject you can give pedagogy. Pedagogy you don't give separately, you give with the pedagogy. Other thing is motivation, all those parts. But that is not the important part. With the teachers is part four subject. See, willing or non-willing is slowly among the 1600, there will be a few who are willing and majority who are not willing. But after these willing people are trained, after some time they see, and the others also get to this willing. And when their atmosphere is built, that everybody says, oh, Azim Premji Foundation, the training is very good, why don't you come? That word of mouth helps a lot. So there, see, among the, when people do analysis, they say 20% excellent teachers, you don't need to work with them. 20% worst teachers, even if you work, nothing helps, absence with them. So the 60% are the teachers with whom you can work for a complete change of the entire. For that, these 20% of the teachers will help you. So here also what we have done is, we did not have a lot of knowledge in the initial stages. So we picked a lot of good teachers, resource teachers, helped them, trained them, ex-teachers. Some of them are good teachers, very good teachers, a loss for the school. Some of them are basically teachers who would like to do some small politics. Go here, there, go to the MLA. So, but they are fine. Yeah.
So, when you started, you made those five circles, the five areas that you are. So, the multi-literacy works across all five areas.
Yes. All five areas. So, if you see all our programs, it will fall in one of the buckets. The teacher learning center will fall on the teacher academic development. The MEDA will fall in the community participation. So each one will fall in one part. We see this program is a very dynamic program. In 214 indicators, we started with. But today we are not having 214 indicators. We felt that this is too much. So then we re-looked at it. Relooking is, we went to the field, Karo was with us, we went to the field, we saw which indicator is viable, which can be done, which cannot be measured, how can it be measured, does it make any meaning at this point of time. And then we came to 60 indicators. Now what we are having is 60. And in that also, we have a few indicators which are seen every 15 days. Few of them every 30 days, few of them every quarter, and a few of them annually. So these annually ones are ones which need skill, understanding, and expertise, and also some of the infrastructure. Because this year, if you have this infrastructure, it is there. You have not had this. Yes, then it will be for you. Yeah.
You mentioned the 240 indicators. Before the school improvement program, on an average, how many of these indicators are fulfilled by the school?
See, I think you will have some different this, but on an average, I think before we started, some 30% of the schools might have some 70% of the. Or 50% of the indicators. But very interesting thing happens. After at 2008, we saw that majority of them had 75% of the indicators. Majority of them. But the learning levels were not relating to this. That is how we started thinking, rethinking on that and started working. So working on indicators is a very serious thing, in the sense when you form the indicators, they should really indicate. But we found one interesting thing, that if you leave this 214 indicators, if you concentrate on 6 or 7 indicators in a year, then it is possible to have all the 6 indicators. So you can concentrate on it. We did that. So we tried a lot of other different things, different possibilities, like library, the environment, clean drinking water. These type of very important indicators, 6 of them we took, and in 1 year we said we all the schools will have this. So majority of the schools.
Yeah, one very good question about.
So what were the 2 or 3 interventions which had highest causality to learning?
See, two things. One is teacher academic development, our work with the teacher to build the capacity. And that we worked with the margaritas. Since you have asked this, see, our margaritas initially, when they were taken in 2005, they were taken to just collect the data. They were just marking the data that is there. Yes, no. From that, to really intervene inside the classroom was a major change that happened. And that made the difference. Now initially, how Hardy did this, I will just share. So once he started training, he gave a base training on subjects, and then he said, next 6 months, you will just observe classroom. You will not say a single word to the teacher. You are not allowed to say anything to the teacher. You will just observe the classroom. So next 6 months, they observe the classroom. After observing the classroom, next 6 months, he said, you will take one class. Every day you will take one class. You will prepare and you will take one class. So the next 6 months, they took one class. After that 1 year, involvement and engagement inside the classroom, the next year, they were able to dialogue with the teachers. They had earned that. Am I making sense? See, otherwise, teachers are very good. They are really intelligent. They can counter you with anything and everything. Because they are intelligent, they are CET, they have come through CET. They are very good. Now what happens is, you will have to gain respect for them to listen to you. And that respect you can gain only through work. Work in their space, not anywhere else. So inside their classroom, if you have taken classes, and if they have seen the classes being good, children responding, and you conducting classes without hitting any child, then you can say, corporal punishment is bad. I don't believe in corporal punishment. So that is how they started working inside the classroom. And we did, see, initially to understand how children learn, we did creativity workshop for children. And creativity workshop for children is 3 days, you engage with children with activities. To see how they engage with activities, what is it that interests them, what is their learning, way of learning. And this we did across, I think, nearly 150 schools. And slowly, that is how Margadashis gained knowledge about engaging with children. And that is how they started working with teachers. Now, they produce worksheets, they conduct small training programs for teachers, and we have subject level groups. So, these type of things happen. It's a long way, but that is the only way. Gaining respect.
Yeah. You have talked about sustainability and also in relation to that
partnership on this.
Yeah.
By the stakeholders. So I think there are multiple stakeholders. It's difficult to see whether children will take ownership of it. They always are taking ownership by coming to school. So I mainly want to talk about community partnership.
Talk about
community. How, what do we see as taking ownership of the by the community of this kind of a program?
Community is the most difficult to take ownership. I think because of some historical reasons also, probably school was always seen as not ours, the government's time. So that is their thing, and they don't take ownership. Now, through the jata, through focus group discussion, through the medas, we have started interacting and going closer to the community. Now what happens is, when they come inside the school, they speak, and then issues get discussed. The teacher also shares issues. Slowly the community takes a few responsibilities. Probably, see, land is a major issue in that area. Land, in the sense, what has happened is, earlier, your grandfather has given that land. And that time it was not very important. It did not fetch much. But today that same land fetches you a lot. And you don't have any records. The government doesn't have records. So then they will fight. They will say the land given was not 5 acres, 6 acres. It was just 1 acre where the school is. So the playground will not be there. So these type of things. In these type of issues now, slowly the community has started intervening, speaking to that person, saying this is a school, we should have a playground. What a school without a playground? If there is no water, they have started going to the gram panchayat, see if there is something earmarked for the water, borewell, get that borewell to the school. So these type of things have started happening. So this, our school, that has started happening in a few schools, small majority. In some big majority, people have started. There are a few schools where the community is completely against the students, against the head teacher, or this teacher. Some teacher is there who is very bad, so that part is also. But it's a very slow process. And then we have not come to the stage of parents coming and taking classes. Those type of things.
No, not so much
on that.
On responsibility. The state's responsibility
is
to just engage.
We do see the responsibility coming. At least many schools, we have youths standing in front of these schools.